Bishop Thomas J. Sills, the senior pastor of the Connors Temple Baptist Church, taking this time to invite you to worship with us as we worship without walls every Sunday morning at 9:55 a.m. at 510 West Gwinnett Street. But we're not just a church, we're family, so come on home.
Yes, he can feel me, because living he loves me, died and he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rise, he justified, he freed me forever. One day.
Choose to rejoice and be glad it is. It is time to sow. It is our sowing time as we sow on Wednesdays, as we study God's Word every single Wednesday. Let me apologize for the technical difficulties that we had this morning. It was pre-recorded. I had the opportunity to pre-record our service, our sow time, our study on Wednesday, to be able to have my pastor here with me and study. And so if you are here at 7 o'clock hour and you didn't see this morning, I want you to go and listen to this morning Bible study. It was distorted for a little while, and it cleared up. With man-made stuff, there are technical difficulties. But however, we are here to study God's Word together. I want to again say thank you to each and every one of you who played a part in our installation service. Whether you came, whether you prayed, whether you gave, whatever you did, I want to say thank you. It was a day to remember, and I will be eternally grateful for each and every one of you. Well, it's time now to get into God's Word, but before we do that, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we come in the name of Jesus, thanking you for your goodness, thanking you for your mercy. We bless you with the opportunity to live life on this side. And we know that we're here because we are to give you the glory, we are to give you the honor, we are to give you the praise. Let our life be a living testimony of your goodness and your mercy. We love you with everything in us, and we ask, Heavenly Father, that you will feed us through your word. Bread of heaven, feed us until we want no more. Father, we come to study for ourselves, approve unto you tonight. A workman that needeth not to be ashamed, but one that can rightly divide the word of truth. Speak to us through your word, and we will forever be blessed. And we ask it all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, family, hello everybody on Facebook, hello everybody on YouTube. Grab the Bibles. We are in the 20th chapter of the book of Matthew. It has really been an awesome time studying, and I want to say to each and every one of you who are faithful to our Bible studies, hey, I'm watching. Yes, I am. I see who's on here, who's commenting. I know there's people on that does not comment, and that's fine. And thank you for being on study with us. And I pray that you are being fed, and I pray that the Word of God is sharpening you to become better Christians, but most of all, to become better individuals. So again, I want to say thank you. All right, let's get into the 20th chapter of the book of Matthew. What I'm going to do is I'm going to recap what we studied at the 11:30 hour, and then I think I'm going to finish this 20th chapter of the book of Matthew. So let's see. But let's go to recap. Now, when you look at verses number 1, oh God, all the way until verse number, starting at verse number 1 and starting at verse number 16. It is a story of this householder which went out early in the morning, and he is now going to find people to labor in his vineyard. And when he had found his first laborers in verse number 2, he offered them a penny a day to go to work. And they agreed, and they went into the vineyard. But in the third hour, he saw some more standing idle in the market. And what did he say to them? He said, I want you to go into my vineyard, and whatsoever is right, I will give you. And guess what they did? They went their way. And then at the sixth hour and the ninth hour, he did the same things. Offered them to go work, and he promised them that when you go work, and he said, whatsoever is right, you shall receive. And so when he comes to now the vineyard and it's time to pay people for the labor that they have given, whether they went out to work at the first call, the second call, or the third call, he's ready to pay them. And he starts paying at the people who work the least on time. And he gave them a penny for working. The second people he called to work, he paid them and gave them a penny for working. And the very first people he called to work, he called them in and gave them a penny for their work. Now, the problem comes in because the one who went to work first is upset, is bothered, is perplexed, is angered, is frustrated, because here it is, these people, they're getting paid the same amount of money that they got paid, and they felt like they were cheated because they only worked an hour or 2 hours. They had been working there all day. First of all, when they went into the vineyard, they agreed to one penny. Those that went every other call, whether it was the third hour, whether it was the seventh hour, whether it was the 11th hour, it didn't make a difference. The householder never promised them a penny. He only promised to give them whatsoever was right. You can argue that maybe he gave them a penny because they did just as much work as those who did that day. But the householder felt within himself, when I give to one, I'm going to give to all. Here's the problem, my brothers and my sisters. One thing that we cannot do as Christians is that we cannot get into this thing where we get angry with God because he rewards people according to what he does. As well as the unjust. God blesses who he blesses. He gives to whom he gives. He does what he wants to do. And in his infinite wisdom, the householder felt like the ones that worked the 11th hour, 7th, 3rd hour, who went to work first, all deserve the same pay. And who am I? Who are you to argue with God? God blesses who he blesses. The good part about it is that they got paid for their labor. Catch this. When the Lord comes back, everybody will have a payday. Why? Because the wages, the pay for sin is death. But the pay for right living is eternal life. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is what? Eternal life. Then Jesus went on, and his disciples really are wondering. I do want to say this. One thing he said in verse number 16, so the last shall be first and the first last, for many are called, but few are chosen. Many people are called to the safety of God, but only a few people really take that call. Whatever you do, receive what God is trying to do. That's right. Receive it. Receive what he's trying to do in your life. If you hear him calling, he said, if you hear my voice, and then you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Let me come and be your God, and you be my people. Verse 17 says, and Jesus going up to Jerusalem took the 12 disciples apart in the way and said unto them, behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. And the third day he shall rise again. When I heard this, I thought about the first hymn I learned how to line as a junior deacon here in church. Must Jesus bear the cross alone?
There's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. Jesus wants them to understand that his mission and his ministry is coming to a head. He wants them to understand that he's going to be betrayed. He wants them to understand that preachers, scribes, they're going to condemn him to death. He wants them to understand that Gentiles are going to mock him and scourge him and crucify him, but he gives them a promise. And the third day, oh glory to God, the third day he shall rise again. I try to close every sermon out. Some preachers close sermons out by going through the whole storyline of Jesus dying on the cross. I close sermons out by declaring, live and he loved me. Died and he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified. He freed me forever. And guess what, my brothers and my sisters? One day, he's coming back. Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious day is going to be when God himself comes for me and you. Oh, what a glorious day it was when he died, even though it was a gory scene. It was a blessed scene, because what he did on Calvary was there to be able to secure our eternal victory. The cross is not a sign of defeat. The cross is a sign of victory. And if it had not been for the shedding of the blood, come on, there would be no remission of sins. So he wants the disciples to know that these things are getting ready to come to pass.
Don't you be downhearted. 3 days later. Hallelujah. 3 days later. I'm a firm believer that what God wants to do for us,
we only need 3 more days.
To your life tonight, 3 more days and you're going to see a turnaround. You've been waiting on the answer. You've been waiting on a decision. 3 more days. And when he does it, I want you to inbox me and tell me that God did it and not another.
Some of his children, she comes with a son, and she comes to Jesus, and she wants to ask Jesus a question. I want my sons, one to sit on your left hand, and one to sit on your right. I want to know that my boys are successful in the kingdom. I want my boys to have great position, great status. Here's the problem I have. There's too many people in the household of faith who want position but don't want the work. They want the title, but they do not want the work. I'm bothered, I'm perplexed, I'm angry, I'm just troubled, because I see many people who want seats of authority but don't want to have a servant mentality. Why do you say that? Because I'm not a preacher who sits in a pulpit and looks cute. When it comes to the kingdom of God, I believe in getting my hands dirty. When it comes to the kingdom of God, I believe in going to work. I believe in making sure I do whatever needs to be done to make sure God's program runs uninterrupted. To make sure that we give God the best worship that we can. I'm not concerned about this. I'm concerned about what we're presenting as pure heart. The Bible even said there's a bunch of people who's dressed up. They look just like sepulchers or sepulchers. They look just like graves, beautiful on the outside. But on the inside, they're full of dead men's bones. So I believe in working. I believe in doing what needs to be done for the kingdom of God. Listen, we all work to get saved. We work in the house of God and for the kingdom of God because we are saved. We do it because it's been good to us. Are y'all here with me tonight? We do it because he saved us. We do it because he's delivered us. We don't do it because we're trying to work by way of him. Because it's not by works, it's in him, it's in both. But it's by faith. Are you here with me? So I'm going to rest on the field of my head and say, you're living it. Here's what Jesus says. Verse 22. You don't need a lot to ask him for. Because they've been able to transform the saints from the world to the earth. I'm ready to be baptized in the same baptism. I'm ready to be baptized in the same baptism. We are able. Do you really know what you're asking for? That's why I keep saying, well, give me the patience of Job. I don't want Job's patience. Because I don't know if I can go through all the things that Job went through. They're going to drink from my cup. They're going to be baptized with my baptism. But it is not for me to give them a seat on my right and left. Verse number 23 says, it's for whomever my Father has prepared to sit there. I've often heard this before, and it makes sense to me. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. This is not one of them things that you can name it and claim it and blab it and grab it. You've got to make sure that your life is that exemplary of a Christian. We must live right all the days of our life. I am afraid of people who always playing tricks and games. I just told a couple of people the other day, is that I don't do politics, and I don't even do church politics, because when it comes to the kingdom of God, if you have a true relationship with God, then what you do for Him, He will reward you according to the heart in which you do it in, and the spirit in which you do it. If you're going to do something for somebody, you should always tell
people what you've done.
Hallelujah. And so, he said, it's not even mine to give your boys position. My daddy will take care of that. Look at verse number 24. And when the king heard it, they should fix the two brothers. Here's the problem. Now the disciples is upset. They're bothered. Why? Because these two brothers and their mother come looking for position, and they're disciples with Jesus. And they catch an attitude. Let me help you out. If you want to be in God, you must not be easily offended. Come on back. Let me say that one more time. If you're going to be in God, you must not be easily offended, because the enemy will do what he can to bring offense to you so that you will not do what God has called you to do. What happens when you get offended? You want to quit. You want to throw in the towel. You want to say, I don't have to take all that. Why? Because you got offended. Listen, the enemy doesn't just want you. He wants the God that operates on the inside of you. He's trying to stop the ministry of God. He's trying to stop God's agenda. And when you get offended, you get in your feelings, and then before you know it, you shut down as if you've got time to waste. Come on, none of us know when our day is up. None of us know when our number is called. And you can't stop now. You must work the works of Him that sent you while it is day, because night is coming. Do you hear me tonight? Where no man can work. And so you can't get in your feelings. You can't get in yourself and don't want to do what God has called you to do because you got easily offended. If they don't thank you, God will reward you. If they don't appreciate you, God will reward you. If they don't recognize you, God will reward you. You got it, Jim? If you see
appreciated, God will reward you.
If you see overlooked, God will reward you. Stop putting your hope and you want your applause from man. Because man will applaud you today and say, crucify you later. Oh, bless His holy name. Let's go to verse 25, if I feel a preacher. But Jesus called unto them and said, you know that the prince of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. But it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant. Let me rewind the tape. He said, you're getting offended by these brothers, and you don't realize the enemy is using them. He's using them to come after me. Stop being offended. Listen to this. I want to read this in the Message Bible. Listen to this. When the 10 others heard about this, they lost their tempers. Thoroughly disgusted with the two brothers, so Jesus got them together to settle this thing down. He said, you've observed how godless rulers throw their weight around. How quickly a little power goes to their head. It's not going to be that way with you. Whoever wants to be great must become a servant. Whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave. This is what the Son of Man has done. He came to serve, not to be served. And then to give away His life in exchange for the many who are held hostage. Jesus says, don't be twisted. Understand what the enemy is trying to do. And understand that these young men are being puppets by those that are stronger and have dominion over them. But you won't be like that. You won't be power seekers. You will not be one who's seeking authority and seeking recognition. It won't be that thing with you. Oh, bless his holy name. He said it will not be that way with you. But if you don't be, if you're going to be great, you must be a minister. And if you're going to be a chief, you must be a servant. Minister is simply a servant. So Jesus says, if you want to be great, be a servant. If you want to be chief, be a servant. Let God see you serving and reward you for your service. Ruth got Boaz because she was a servant. I don't hear nobody talking. You must will be willing to be a servant in the kingdom of God. Stop looking for title. Stop looking for position. Look to see how you can serve. Look and see how you can be a blessing. Watch this. You need to be careful because there are rulers in churches in our country that's using people and manipulating people to do their evil deeds. Proverbs 17 and 19 says, he who loves a quarrel loves sin. He who builds a high gate invites destruction. In other words, he who always likes confusion loves sin. And there are people who will start confusion just to set you up. Matthew 23 and 12 says this, for whoever exalts himself will be humbled. Whoever humbles himself will be exalted. If you want elevation, it's going to take submission. Whoever wants elevation has to make some in their spirit. You knock some things down so you can be humble. Pride. And to be humble, oh, bless his holy name. Jesus says, even I didn't come to be ministered to, but I came to minister to give my life as ransom. I came to be a servant. I didn't come to be served. I came to show you that I'm willing to do what it needs to be done to win people into the kingdom of God. I'm afraid of anybody who wants position but don't want to serve. I'm afraid of anybody who wants to sit down and look great but don't want to work. Or even as me as a pastor, I'm looking at people day and night. Whenever we get together, we do something here in our church, I'm looking to see who's working. I'm looking to see who don't mind getting in the trenches and do what needs to be done so that the kingdom of heaven can go forward. I'm looking. Because you can't be a leader if you don't want to be a servant. You have to be willing to get down and dirty. I'm grateful, down and dirty. I'm grateful that I'm young, that I can do some of this stuff. At least I still feel like I'm young. I can do some of these things that some older people can't do or cannot do. But then I look at some people who is well able, who don't want to work, but want to be a part. Jesus said, if you're going to be my servant, you got to be like me. I didn't come to serve. I mean, to be served, I came to serve. And to give myself as a ransom. I beseech you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, that you do what, Pastor Sills? Present your what? Bodies. A living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service. You must be willing to give of yourself. Bless this holy name. I'm going to challenge you to do something in just a minute. Watch this. Here we go. Verse 29. And as they departed from Jericho, a great multitude followed him. And behold, two blind men sitting by the wayside. And when they heard that Jesus passed by, they cried, saying, have mercy on us, O Lord, thy son of David. And the multitude rebuked them because they should not, the multitude rebuked them because they should hold their peace. But they cried the more, saying, have mercy on us, O Lord, thy son of David. And Jesus stood still and called them and said, what will ye that I shall do unto you? And they said unto him, Lord, that our eyes may be opened. And Jesus had compassion on them and touched their eyes. And immediately their eyes received sight, and they followed him. Now I'm going to show something in this text that when you look at the synoptic gospels, Matthew writing is very interesting because Matthew remembered two blind people. The other synoptic gospels only remembers one person. But the moral of the story is still the same. All right? Jesus now is departing from Jericho, and when he's leaving, a great multitude follow him. Now watch this. Two blind men. Listen. Two blind men by the wayside, when they heard that Jesus passed by, they cried. I couldn't see him, but I heard he's passing by. Not only do they cry for him, but they call him by his messianic name, thou son of David. We know your lineage. We know who you are. We know that you are the healer. We know that you are the deliverer. And when they cried for mercy. The multitude rebuked them, and you got to be careful because some people may tell you it don't take all of that. Don't take all that hollering. It don't take all that shouting. Listen, if you can't take the hollering and shouting down here, you better not go to heaven. Because this thing about quadrillions, I can't even think how many people will be there. I just take a number that no man can number, is what John said. I saw a number that no man can number. Can you imagine? Bless his holy name. Can you imagine just innumerable amount of men and women and children praising God, giving God the glory because of his goodness and because of his mercy? Can you imagine that? Can you imagine people singing glory, hallelujah, is the Lamb of God? So if you can't take noise down here, you really better not go to heaven because it's really going to be noisy up there. Oh, just thought about something. You can't go to hell either. Because the Bible says there's going to be wailing and gnashing of teeth. So if you are one who can't, you don't want to hear nobody hollering and shouting, the Bible says they rebuke them. Not just one of them, the multitude. Why? Because they saw blind people as people that was less than. But here's the problem. You can see them, but you ain't praising them. You can see them, but you ain't crying out to it. We heard that he was passing by. And it's very important, though, you deal with when they said they heard, because Romans 10 declares faith coming by hearing. Oh, bless his holy name. So they heard that Jesus would come, and they hollered, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy. Oh, Lord, thou son of David, have mercy on us. What happens when they call the Lord? He stood still. Millions of people can call God right now. And when you call him, he stands still. Jesus stood still. And when he stood still, he said, bring him to me. Now, the same people that told him to hush, and the same people had to say, the master calls you. And their praise. Him calling Jesus is a form of praise. Their praise got them an audience with the Lord and a blank check. Oh, glory to God. Let me say that one more time. Their praise got them an audience with God and a blank check. What do you see a blank check at? Verse 32. Where is it at, Pastor? It's in red. What will ye that I shall do unto you? What you want from me? It was a blank check. He said, whatever you want, just go and tell me. Verse 33, they said that our eyes may be open. And what did Jesus do? The Bible says he had compassion on them and touched their eyes. and immediately their eyes received sight, and they didn't just get a blessing, they followed after God. There are some people who've begged God for blessings. You've begged God for miracles. You've begged God to do a whole bunch of stuff in your life, and then after he does it, you don't come back. Oh, there's some people who come to church when things are going bad. Lord, if you just answer me this time. Lord, if you just get me out this time. I promise. And as soon as he gets you out, now church ain't no good. Oh, I ain't got time to go there today. They follow Jesus. Because if this man can restore my sight, he can do whatever I need him to do. I believe everything in me that God will heal our nation if we start calling on him together. If my people, hallelujah, which are called by my name, if we will humble ourselves, pray, seek his face, and turn from our wicked ways, then he'll hear from heaven. Hear from heaven. Then he'll forgive our sins. Then he'll heal our land. Here is the answer to the pandemic. God's people got to get together. We are some of the most divided people. How are you going to be a Christian and you don't like folk you worship with? How are you going to call yourself a child of God and you won't tell God who you can't work with or who can't do this to you and who can't do that? Who are you to tell God who to use? How can you call yourself a Christian and don't like people? There is nobody in the world that I can't get along with. There's nobody in the world that I can't worship with, that I can't celebrate the Lord with. Why? Because is it worth you dying and going to hell because you don't like so-and-so? You don't like where they come from? You don't like they don't have the education that you have? Come on, my brothers and my sisters. They follow Jesus. Blind folk, you know, scripturally, they were beggars. They couldn't work. Nobody wanted no beggar with us. Please, just tell the truth. Tell the truth what God has saved you from. What he's saving you from right now. None of us are what we should be. Hallelujah. But thank God we ain't what we used to be. And as long as God keeps his hand on us, we're not what we yet going to be. This is what we must understand as children of God. You are not all of that. I am not all of that in the bag of chips. And if we're going to win people into the kingdom of God, if we're going to win people into the household of faith, they may come and burn. They may come in not dressing like we dress in the best Sunday go to meet and tie that they can put their hands on. But God is looking at that anyway. How do you know the Bible says man look at the outward appearance? God looks at the heart. Bless his holy name. Some people right now, you can see, but you're still blind. Because you see too much of what you want to see and not the ways of God. And our day and night.
Holler up towards heaven.
Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy.
Thank you for spending this time with me. I told you I wanted to challenge you
to do something for me tonight. I want to challenge you real quickly to do something for me tonight. I believe in sowing. You know what I tell you? I believe sowing is where it's at. I want you to do this right now. I want you to take your cellular device, whether you have a laptop or a computer, and I want you to sow. Right now. I want everybody listening today to go on Cash App or Pushpay and sow a $10 offer. was blessed today to open up this morning, what do they call it, a prayer for Calvary Baptist Church in Richmond Hill. Pastor Stanford Anderson. Blessed me with the opportunity to minister to them this morning on their prayer call, give their inspirational message of prayer. And the Lord instructed me, and I want to say, let's see if I can find exactly what it was, but it was in the book of Genesis. And in the book of Genesis, it talks about that Isaac sowed during the time of a famine. That's what it talked about. Genesis 26. It talks about, I think it's Genesis 26 and 12, if I'm right. Yeah, Genesis 26 and 12. And Isaac sowed in that land and received in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. I believe in sowing seed. I challenge the people of Calvary Baptist Church of Richmond Hill this morning to sow out of hearts. Stay with me if you want to, but at least $10. I'm sending my seed for our stage outside. But I want you to sow. Right now. I want you to sow your seed and watch God bless you supernaturally. I'm getting ready to pray. Something happened in my seed and I'll go through it. So I got to do this again. I'm not going to get off here until I sow my seed. All right, I know it's dead time, you're not supposed to do that. But I wanted to make sure I sowed my seed. I don't know if you can see that. Hold on. I don't know if you can see that. I'm holding up, you can't. But if you see that green down there, you know that's symbolic that I just sowed my seed. I want you to sow yours right now. I want you to sow it right now. And then I want you to do me a favor. When God blesses you, like I know he's going to bless you, can you do me a favor? You're a member of Connors Temple, make sure you call me, tell me. I'm up to the church Tuesday through Friday, drive-in service. Hey, let me know. I want to hear the blessings of the Lord. Thank you for spending this time with me. Next week, we are in this 21st chapter of the book of Matthew, and I'm just excited about what the Lord is doing here at 509 West Gwinnett Street, right here at Connors Temple Baptist Church. I'm excited, and I believe that our better and our best days are yet to come. Come on, will you pray with me? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your loving kindness and your tender mercies. Heavenly Father, today, help us, oh God, help us to sow our time, our talent, and our treasure. Help us to do like we did today, study on Wednesday. But not just Wednesday, God, help us study on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. For at the end of this life, we've got to hear you say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Your servant's prayer, in Jesus' name, amen. Hey, y'all, love you to life. Please know that better days are here. Most of all, better days they are ahead. Bye-bye.
Oh, I'm Reverend Bishop Thomas J. Sills, the senior pastor of the Connors Temple Baptist Church, taking this time to invite you to worship with us as we worship without walls every Sunday morning at 9:55 a.m. at 510 West Gwinnett Street. But we're not just a church, we're family, so come on home.
He can feel me because living he loved me. Died and he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified. He freed me forever. One day.